Hello and welcome to Physics Platter. In Physics Platter, today we will be talking about Kepler's laws of planetary motion. Okay, Kepler stated three laws to explain the planetary motion, which are termed as first, second and third law. Okay, first law is also called as the law of orbits. Law of orbits, because this law it basically explains the structure of the orbits of the planets. Alright, it states that all the planets are revolving around the sun in an elliptical path with the sun at one of its foci. Okay, what does it mean? It means that if we imagine an ellipse like this, which has two foci of course, then the sun is at one of its foci, let's say here at the first one, and this is S, let's say, and the planets are moving around the sun following this elliptical path. All right so this is the first law, which talks about the structure of the planetary orbits. All right okay, then the second law, let's move on to the second law, which is also called the law of aerial velocity. It states that the line joining the sun and the planet, let's say this is P, planet, the line joining the sun and the planet sweeps out equal amount of area in equal interval of time. I repeat, the line joining the sun and the planet sweeps out equal amount of area in equal interval of time. Okay, that's why it is called the aerial law also. Okay, what does it mean? If we imagine the line joining the sun and the planet as SP, this is the line, then let's say there are two, let me draw it here again, let's say this is the elliptical path of the planets. Okay, the sun is somewhere here, this is, let's say, sun, this is another focus of course, this is sun. Let's say planet P moves from position A to B in time T. Alright. And again from B, let's say from here this is C, from C to D, C to D in the same time T. Alright. Okay, so the planet moves from A to B at time interval T, and then from C to D at the same time interval T. Alright. Then if we imagine a line joining the planet and the sun, let's say this is SB and SA. SA, and then here is CB, CSC and SD. Okay, so the area swept out by the earth or the planet in this interval of time T for the first interval is, let's say, A1, and the second interval, which is this one, this is the area swept out by this line, which is S A2, let's say, then the second law states that A1 equals to A2, or the area under the triangle ABS equals to the area under the triangle CDS. Okay, here you have to remember that the time interval for both the sections are exactly equal. Okay, also this law states that the velocity of the planet, obviously the velocity of the planet when it is nearer to the sun is greater than the velocity of the planet when it is farther from the sun. Okay, that means when the planet is at A, the velocity of the planet is much less. If this is velocity VA, let's say, or V1, and at C the velocity is V2, let's say, then V1 is less than V2. Okay, this law also states that. And from the structure it is very clear that the farthest point from the sun is, if we join the two foci with a line and extend that like this, then this is the farthest point from the sun, and this is the nearest point from the sun, nearest point of the earth from the sun, or the planet from the sun. Okay, so this is, let's say, if we consider this as P1 and P2, or let me call this one P1 and this one as P2, then the velocity at P1 is less than the velocity at P2. Alright. Okay, and also the velocity at P2 is the maximum velocity of the planet, and velocity at P1 is the minimum velocity of the planet. Alright. Here we can say that the equal interval of time T, the area traversed by the area swept out by the planet is A2, right? So the velocity of the aerial velocity rather, the aerial velocity, how do you define that? Aerial velocity is defined as the area swept out per time. That means for the first part, aerial velocity VA1 equals to what? A1 divided by T. Alright, and aerial velocity of A2 for this part is equals to A2 by T. Alright, now these T and T are same, and A1 and A2 are also same. So A1 equals to A2, and of course T are same, therefore it gives that the aerial velocity at A1 equals to aerial velocity also for the second area. Okay, that means the aerial velocity of the planet throughout its motion in the elliptical path remains constant. That also the statement, that also the conclusion from the second law of Kepler, which is the law of aerial velocity. Okay, that's why it is called the law of velocity actually. Okay, so this is the second law, and then let's move on to the third law. Third law, which is also called the law of time period. Law of time period, which states that the cube of the semi-major axis of the ellipse is proportional to the square of the time period of the planet. Okay, so the third law, which is the law of time period, states that the cube of the semi-major axis, it is proportional to the square of the time period of the planets. Okay, time period of the revolution. What does it mean? Okay, what is semi-major axis here? Semi-major axis is, for an ellipse, there are two axes, of course, the lengthwise axis and the breadthwise axis. Okay. And of course there are two foci. Okay, so the lengthwise axis, which is a bigger axis, is called the major axis, which we can call at here at AB, and the breadthwise axis, which is, let's say, CD, is called the minor axis. Okay, so there's half of the, this is the center of the ellipse, let's say. So half of the major axis is called the semi major axis, which is denoted as A. Therefore, the length of the semi-major axis is 2A, and length of the major axis is 2A, and if the semi-minor axis is B, then length of the minor axis is 2B. Alright, so the cube of the semi-major axis is proportional to the square of the time period of the revolution of the planets. Alright, what is the meaning of time period? Time period is, what is the meaning of time period? Time period is a time taken by the planets to complete one full revolution, one full rotation around the sun. Alright, that means if the planet starts from B, it will again come back to B. And the time taken by the planet to do that is called the time period here. Alright, this statement here can roughly be also said that if the R is the mean distance from the sun to the planet. Okay, because the distance is always changing all the time because it's an ellipse. So if we take a mean distance or the average distance of the planet from the sun as R, then this R cube is proportional to the square of the time period. Or in another way, we can say that R cube by T square equals to a constant. Alright, so this is a very important statement, okay, which defines the which also states about the distance of the earth, distance of the planet from the sun, and the time period. Okay, now if we take, let's say, two planets somewhere, this is the sun, let's say, and one planet has the orbit like this and another planet has the orbit like that. Okay, the first planet has a distance r1 and the second planet has a distance from the sun is r2, which are the average distances, of course. Then we can say that, and the time period for the second one is, let's say, t2, and the first one is, let's say, t1. Then we can say that r2 cubed by t2 square equals to, of course, a constant which if we call as k, then r1 cubed by t1 square is also equals to constant, which is the same constant as k. So we can say that r1 cubed by t1 cubed equals to r2 cubed by t2 cubed, which we can also consider, which we can also write as the r2 by r1 whole cubed equals to t2 by t1 whole square. This is a very important formula to solve the numericals of the planetary motion. Okay, so these are the three statements of the Kepler's law of planetary motion. All right, okay, that's all for today's lecture. See you in the next video. Till then, take care.